today's video, I'm going to go over what it takes to spin up the Lexus GS450H hybrid transmission for the first time. And unlike some of the other videos that you may have seen, which just show everything connected and the guy just presses the throttle pedal and everything works and spins, I'm going to take our time and my time and bring out all the pieces one by one, introduce them, then connect them on camera, and hopefully not get embarrassed when we do press the throttle pedal and it actually spins. This is a blank canvas. That is the Lexus GS450H transmission. This one is out of a 2010 model, but it really doesn't matter. As long as you stick to the newer version, 2007 to 2011, I think, before they switched to Gen 2, I believe what I'm about to do here will work. This is a battery. This is a hybrid vehicle, high voltage battery, or be it electric vehicle, a high voltage battery. Actually, no, it's not. It's just a bench power supply. We're going to use this to simulate a battery just to keep things simple. This is to show you that you don't need to have a 360 volt battery to test this transmission. Also, I'm just not strong enough and too lazy to pull my actual hybrid battery out here, but that's okay. The point of the video is that you can use something like this. This is only 30 volts, I believe 10 amps. They do make one like this that is 60 volts, 5 amps. So either one will work. You can actually take literally two car batteries, two 12 volt car batteries, connect them together in series to give you 24 volts, and that would be enough to spin this motor, I believe. I know people have done it with about 25 volts, so that should work. So we'll use this as our battery. An inverter. Now, what is an inverter? About 10 years ago, when I got into electric cars, things were simple. You get your donor vehicle, a truck, some old truck, and you get a forklift motor. You know, it's called the DC motor, runs direct current. You get yourself some car batteries, say, you know, 10 or 12 of them. You shove them in the bed of the truck. Throttle, controller, hook it up together, and you got yourself an electric vehicle, a system that's working, because you're taking DC battery from DC power from a battery and sending it to a DC forklift motor. There's no need translate anything, if you will, from AC to DC or DC to AC. But in the last 10 years, technology has evolved and changed, and now we're using AC motors. So this unicorn here, I say that because it's a transmission, sometimes I call it transmotor, because this thing has an electric motor inside of it. This is essentially our power plant, our drivetrain. This is our electric motor. Technically, it has two electric motors inside of it, but they are AC, okay, alternating current. Problem being, batteries are DC, direct current. So you can't just hook up DC power to an AC device and expect it to work. So in comes this box called an inverter. Now, what does it do? I'm probably the last guy on earth to explain to you how it works, but simply, it translates. For instance, if I have a BMW hybrid battery in the garage, high voltage battery, BMW being German, so using my analogy of translation, the battery speaks German. This is a Japanese Lexus electric motor here. It speaks Japanese. It needs something to translate the two languages. So it translates battery DC power into motor AC power. So that's the inverter. A lot of times these things are what I call all-in-one, meaning sometimes people will call these things controllers, and sometimes they will call them converters. And a lot of times they're right in all three cases. This is an all-in-one unit. It's actually at times three things in one. Ours is two things in one box. On the top here, it really is a converter. And on the bottom, the rest of the unit, I believe, is where the inverter part sits. So if the inverter inverts, if you will, DC power to AC power, and I think also backwards, AC to DC, what does a converter do? Well, a converter will take high voltage from the battery, which is DC, about 360 volts in my case, and convert it down to 12 volts or 13 volts around there for the electronics on the car or to charge the car battery, which brings me to the next item. Regular car battery. Technically, I brought out a deep cycle battery. I just borrowed it from a solar system that I'm making. It could very well be just a car battery, but regular 12, 13 volts, whatever you want to call it. One of the things that people are shocked to learn is that electric cars still very much use a regular car battery. A lot of the electronics are still working on 12 volts. Oftentimes less than that, 5 volts, 3 volts, what have you. But we need a regular car battery, not just here for testing, but actually for a full implementation. When this stuff is in the vehicle, a battery just like this one, a regular car battery you buy at AutoZone, will be in the car. It will run the headlights, taillights, windshield wipers, stereo, whatever. Just a regular car battery. Also, a regular 12-volt battery powers on our inverter. It also will power on the controller, which I am about to bring out next. So this here is the secret sauce. This is what makes it all happen. In order for us to take used electric vehicle parts or used hybrid vehicle parts and make them work outside of the vehicle, it's difficult. You can't just take everything out of a Leaf or a Tesla or a BMW i3 or whatever electric vehicle and make it work outside of the car. Sure, everything is in working order, it's not broken, but it really needs the vehicle to work. Like in this case, it wants a Lexus GS450H, the actual car. Now, maybe not, you know, the doors and the trunk lid or the bumpers, but it wants something like maybe the dash cluster, or it wants to check in if the actual engine, gasoline-powered engine, is running. It may need the body control module and God knows what relays and modules and fuses. But a lot of talented guys on the Open Inverter Forum spent many, many years developing this type of device here. This is a controller. It's called a VCU, Vehicle Control Unit, just to kind of brand it, as opposed to an ECU, Electronic Control Unit, or ECM. You've heard all those terms, PCM, what have you. But this is the brain. This is what makes it all work. And it's amazing piece of technology, but if you just were to simplify it, it takes input signals and sends output signals. So what are those? As an example, if we hook all of this up, this thing's not gonna spin. Even if we wire it all up, it's not gonna spin because nothing is telling it what to do. For that, we need some sort of input. One type of input is a throttle pedal. An electronic throttle pedal will send a signal to this guy and say, hey, spin, right? This guy will translate the voltage from the throttle into proper communication, which we'll learn about in a bit, to the inverter. And then the inverter will send more juice from the hybrid battery to the motor, telling it to spin. It's a simplified version of what happens, but that's pretty much what happens, along with many other controls. So we need the controller. And speaking of a throttle, this is from a BMW E46. It's just a known and tested throttle pedal that Damian McGuire uses. He's the gentleman who developed that circuit board, working with other smart guys, and he sells it as a kit. And he uses this throttle for testing. I believe he also uses a BMW E60. Again, I'm not a BMW expert, but I just try to make things simple where I can. So I'm using a throttle pedal. I'm not sure if drive-by-wire throttle pedals will work. Like if you get a 2010 Chevy Silverado, which may be drive-by-wire, if you can just use that. I know they come sometimes with an external module. This is simple. This is all it is, plus the wiring harness that goes to it. But all the gizmos, electronics are just in here. This is a two-channel, which I believe is maybe for safety and redundancy. In our system, we only use one of the two channels to make it even simpler, easier. And this here is one of the two harnesses that we need. Okay, it's a bit of a mess. I apologize. We'll kind of unwind it and talk about every wire in here and what it does. Being an inverter harness, as opposed to the next one I'll bring out, which is a transmission harness, this one comes with the inverter plug. And a lot of guys look for this plug when they're building their own harnesses. You cannot buy this plug on its own. That's what I believe. It's difficult to find. It's kind of a weird thing. Anyway, we'll use this as the glue that will connect all of this stuff together. And this is what's left of the factory transmission harness. So once you thin it out, you end up with pretty much this is all you need. We have here this plug and these cables. This is the neutral safety switch. This is an important component. The transmission will not spin for safety reasons unless it gets a signal from this key important component, this switch, telling it whether it's in reverse or drive. Okay. It also sends a signal when it's in park, and we'll get to all that. But just to make it spin, it wants to know when it's in gear, essentially. Otherwise, for safety reasons, it will not spin. components are these two resolver wires. One is for MG1 and the other one is for MG2. MG standing for motor generator. That's what their motors in here are referred as. And what are resolvers? Well, in simple terms, resolvers are essentially sensors. They sense the position of the motor as it spins, so it knows, let's say, when it's due north, if you will, or at 1 o'clock or whatever. That's important to figure out RPMs and amongst other things. But when I talk about, you know, the resolver cables, they're motor cables. They connect to our motors, right? We'll talk about how this all gets plugged in once we're actually making the connections. But that's what we need. I hope I didn't leave anything out. So just to review what we have here. So I'm going to call that the motor, okay? So we need a motor, which is our transmission. We need our battery, our high voltage battery, which in our case is a simulation box, if you will. It's a power supply, essentially, that takes power out of the wall, AC power, converts it to DC. Then we have a regular car battery, which is 12 volts, an inverter, throttle pedal, VCU, aka controller, safety neutral switch. We have our inverter wiring harness, and back here we have our resolver cables. And that's pretty much all we need to get this thing to spin. Unbelievable.